Let us pray. O gracious God, we invoke your presence and your power to tabernacle with us here today. Speak through our music, speak through our word, and speak through our worship experience to our hearts, so that we today, as we leave this place, will declare surely we have been with Jesus. And it has been good to have been here. Amen.
saying there is joy in heaven. There is a party in heaven. I would like to invite all the members of the Joshua Weiner family to please stand to witness the baptism of Joshua. The members of the family, the friends, the relatives, everyone that deals with Glendale Academy, please stand. This is your day. I want to recognize anyone involved with Glendale Academy. This is the reason why we do Christian education, salvation. And I want you to be happy with what is happening right now. And Joshua, because you have accepted Jesus as your personal Savior, because you have renounced the world, because you have accepted all the Bible studies given to you by Pastor Ben Garcia, because you have accepted the death and burial of Jesus for the remission of all of your sins, therefore, as a minister of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, I baptize you, Joshua Weiner, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Stand with us as we sing our opening hymn number 262, Sweet, Sweet Spirit.
Oh, shout the holy, for I shall mount above the sky.
here. I'm glad that you're joining us this morning. I want to also give a special welcome to all of our visitors, including our guest artist today. She's joining us again, Grace Chung. And I also understand that today is our choir director, John Zimbri's birthday. Is that correct? So, happy birthday to John. You know, last weekend was Mother's Day, but because of our jam-packed schedule, we postponed our Mother's Day celebration until today. But before I invite Marina Rains forward for our Mother's Day presentation, I just wanted to take a moment and thank all of you for being such a wonderful family, to me for these past almost 6 years I've been at this church. Many of you have been like mothers and fathers and brothers and sisters to me during my time here. So with that, I'm sad to say that next Sabbath will be my last Sabbath here at Vallejo Drive. I wish I could say where I'm going or what I'll be doing, but I feel a bit like Abraham when God said to go to the country that I will show you. Sometimes we have to follow God before we know it is where God is calling us. So I ask for your continued prayers as we all move forward into the future that God has for us. But I just wanted to thank all of you for allowing me to serve you here and for being a great family. So with that being said, Mark, if he's here, do you want to say something, Mark?
Yeah, since I'm not going to be here next week, I just wanted to personally say thank you, Shane, for your service to us. It's been a great blessing. We appreciate you so much. We realize you've got a doctorate to finish, and your career goals were in teaching at university level, and something you have to do, we understand that. We say thank you from the bottom of our hearts for all this. One brief item, we want to vote our candidate who is baptized. Nick, is that the first name? Wayne? Sorry, I was in a rush when I heard it. Joshua, we want to vote Joshua in the membership. We have a motion. So moved and seconded. All those in favor say a hearty amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Joshua. We'll have him in the back so you can meet him afterwards. Marina, come forward and share with us the Mother of the Year.
This is such a full service that I've been told to chip. Well, here we are, another year, and we're going to honor a very, very special woman. But before I get into that, I want to honor my own mother, who is in the back and has been very ill, and thought she would not be coming today, but there she is, or who borrows, my mom. Thank you, Mom, for coming. So today is a day to celebrate amazing women who never stop giving and caring, laughing and loving. Because the special sparkle of God splashes out of their lives. We were once told from this very pulpit that enthusiasm comes from the ancient Greek, en theos asm, within God's spirit. The word means the spirit of God within. The woman we are honoring today is such a person, and we will be honoring her as our Vallejo Drive Woman of the Year, number 14. So, who can find a virtuous woman? Proverbs tells us that her price is far above rubies. The heart of her family doth safely trust in her, for she will do them no harm all the days of her life. Such women have been honored here at Vallejo for over a decade, and if you take a peek at your bulletin on the left side, you will see who they are, and many of them are still with us. I see Grace is there. So, our Mother of the Year, 2018, was born in 1927 into a Catholic home She was living in the homeland of Colombia when, at the tender age of 14, her new life in Jesus Christ began. I better not look at her. Due to the influence of an American missionary, Pastor Baxter, she gave her life to Christ at that time. Still at the same age, in 1941, she began her studies at the Baptist University in Colombia. It was in 1948 that she received her degree in elementary education from the same Adventist University in Medellin, Colombia. Here also is where she met her future husband, a ministerial student, and where they were married some years later in 1952. Our valiant and resourceful Woman of the Year taught elementary school for the Inter-American Division for some 10 years before she and her husband, Augusto Griton, were called by the Lord in 1960 to a life and culture-changing ministry that brought them here to Southern California. Pastor Britton was to be the senior pastor and the only pastor, I think, of San Fernando Seventh-day Adventist Spanish Church. There, this young, energetic, amazing pastor's wife directed and was immersed in the running of all the children's Sabbath schools for 12 years. I would like to ask her how she managed when, during this time, she was having a family of her own. But another ministry was still ahead of her. Our Mother of the Year, 2018, taught Spanish to the San Fernando Academy students for the duration of 48 years, retiring only recently in 2014. At the tender age of 87. While at San Fernando Academy, she took 500 students over on mission trips to the Oasis Orphanage in Mexico, modeling for these young people what it is to be God's emissaries in this world, as they share clothing, money, and food with these orphans. Our Mother of the Year included into her curriculum vitae the teaching of Spanish at our own Glendale Academy, and did that during 2008 and 2009. Some of our young members may have had her as a teacher. At Northridge SDA Church, she worked with the children's ministry program for the bulk of 40 years until the death of her husband in 2007, Dr. Auguste Briton, the father of her three children, Annette, Mavis, and Alex. Collectively, this Olympian and outstanding torchbearer for her Lord taught for the SDA educational worldwide system for 70 years. Amen to that. Thank you. She has been a member of our congregation here at Vallejo Drive for over 10 years now. To her credit as well is the fact that her three children are active members of our church family. Annette Hearn and Mavis both have positions as elders and do Sabbath school leadership. Her son Alex is now part of our music ministry and is a wonderful asset to our choir. I don't see Alex, he must have gone down. Hi Alex. Oh, there you are. Their family involvement ministry extends to the generations of her children and grandchildren. Alinea and Claire participate in the children's choir, and Joseph, Alexander, and James volunteer as deacons and are also part of our music ministry, and I believe they sang at the end of Sabbath school today, right? Thank you. That's so fantastic. Once a teacher, always a teacher. Our devoted woman of the year, at the age of almost 91, still teaches Sabbath school lesson study in her native Spanish at least once a month. She personally makes, now listen to this, each holiday season she personally makes 300 loaves of carrot cakes to share here with her church family. That alone will put me to tears. Proudly and justifiably, her daughter Mavis remarks that the whole family, all three generations, are a product of Seventh-day Adventist Christian education, beginning with the University in Columbia, to San Fernando Academy, to Glendale Academy, La Sierra University, Loma Linda, and Andrews University. A dedicated and most loving pastor's wife, an incredible Adventist teacher, an exceptional mother, and a grandmother who keeps faith in the promise of God found in Proverbs. Train up a child in the way of the Lord, and when he is old, he will come back to it. Beloved church members, it is my privilege and pleasure to introduce to you our Mother of the Year 2018, the beautiful spirit, Mrs. Angela Briton. And I ask that someone will help her come forward. To the Vallejo Drive Church family, contributing to matters of the soul, the heart, and the spirit, and for helping those in need. It is our privilege and pleasure this morning to bestow upon you this well-deserved honor with the affection of your church family, Vallejo Drive's own Mother of the Year, Saturday, May 19th, 2018. We love you so much. Can you please stand and honor this woman?
Taught us when she learned when she was 14 years old. And I would just like to say that our mother He's an example of grace unconditional, the motto of this church. My mother believes she does not delight in evil from 1 Corinthians 13, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, and always hopes, always perseveres. My mother does not judge, she does not harangue, she prays. She does not delight in gossip or in evil doing. One of the greatest compliments one of my stepdaughters said was, I love visiting your grandma because she doesn't care what I wear, she doesn't care what color my hair is, or whether I have a nose ring. And to me, that is grace unconditional. And so we'd like to sing a song, Sitting at the Feet of Jesus, her favorite hymn.
Oh, said one more word. I feel so happy and thank Lord. Because today I am preaching here in the church. And also, my name is my grandchildren, my grandchildren, my four grandchildren are here also. And my son and sister, and my seven children I have, and grandchildren, and my son-in-law is here with us too. Thank you, Lord, and thank you, everybody, for your help.
Deserving person. This has really been an honor for me. We want to invite all the mothers to stand up now because there are flowers coming for each of you. So please stand up. And the children, the youth from the school, the early teens, will be coming up.
And while the mothers are getting the flowers, boys and girls, it's time for you to come up for the children's story. So boys and girls, come on up for the children's story. And all the moms, even in the choir, stand up. We have flowers for you.
Hello, everybody. You know, since we're celebrating moms, one of the best things for us to see is this, you guys. And when you guys smile, and when you guys do funny things or write cards, that's the best day. And something that moms like to do for their kids is to make them yummy things. Right? Or maybe your favorite food. Can anybody tell me something that your mom makes that is your favorite food? Let me see. I see Dylan. Dylan, what's your favorite thing that your mom makes?
She made me a sandwich and I really like it.
Okay, you see mommy sandwiches? I bet they're awesome. Yes.
Mom makes chicken with green beans and carrots and rice. Oh,
that sounds delicious. What else?
My mom's spaghetti.
Spaghetti, okay. Natalie?
My mom's spaghetti.
Oh, spaghetti. Anybody else? Okay, so when I was little, my mom used to make something that in Argentina we call colitos. It's kind of similar to what we here call mac and cheese. And I love mac and cheese. My mom's sauce was way better than that orange thing that you get at the store, but it's similar to mac and cheese. And I'm gonna try it too. boiled it, right? What else? How are we going to give it flavor? Does anybody know?
Add cheese.
Cheese, definitely cheese. Maybe salt, right? It's not ready yet. This is nothing. So what if I tell you that if you talk to the mac and cheese, we can eat it? No. Does anybody believe that? What if I tell you you just talk to the mac and cheese and then we can eat it? No? Well, there's a story in the Bible and it's as crazy as saying, talk to the mac and cheese. God called Prophet Ezekiel and he took him to a place called the Valley of Bones. And the Valley of Bones was full of bones. And God said, I want you to preach to the bones. And they will turn into people. Does that sound crazy? Right? I think that sounds pretty crazy. But Ezekiel did it, and the bones suddenly did turn into people. Now, that story is crazy, and I'll let you guys talk about it a little more with your parents when you get home. But the important thing that I want you guys to remember is this. Even something that sounds impossible, even something that sounds super scary, God can change that into something good. Even when you're sad, even if a friend is being mean, or you have to change schools, or you have to move, or something scary is happening, or mom and dad are arguing, any of those things that make us sad or scared, God can change that into something good. So I want you to remember that. And remember my dry mac and cheese, even that. Okay? And all you need to do is talk to him. Okay? This is it for today. It's time to go to children's worship. So everybody 4 to 12, you're welcome to go to children's worship. If you're 4 to 6, find mommy and daddy so they can walk with you to the class, okay? And I'll actually see if you're 4 to 6, I'll be your teacher, so I'll meet you in the class. Okay, bye everybody.
Will the deacons please come forward? We will now have the doxology after the collection and the offering. We have been blessed, and now it's an opportunity for us to tell the Lord, we love you, and return a love offering. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for everything you have given us, because nothing that we have come from anybody else but from you. Bless this offering as it goes to part of the gospel. We ask in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
to pray to our Father in heaven. Holy God, you spoke the world into being. Pour your Spirit to the ends of the earth and into each of our lives, that your children may return from exile as citizens of your kingdom, that our divisions may be healed by your word of love and righteousness. Father, you have given our church the abiding presence of your Holy Spirit, so look upon us today and hear our petitions. Grant that, gathered and directed by your Spirit, we may confess Christ as our Lord and Savior, and combine our diverse gifts with one singular passion, to continue his mission in this world until we join in your eternal praise. Giver of life, make the dry, bleached bones of our lives live and breathe and grow again as you did of old. Pour out your Spirit upon the whole creation. Come in rushing wind and flashing fire to turn the sin and sorrow within us into faith, power, and joy. Amen.
Today our scripture is, it seems, Ezekiel 37, 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord came upon me and brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of the valley. And it was full of bones. Then he caused me to pass by them all around, and behold, there were very many in the open valley, and indeed they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? So I answered, O Lord God, you know. Again I said, he said to me, prophesy to these bones, and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, surely I will cause breath to enter into you, and you shall live. I will put sinews on you, and bring flesh upon you, cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied, as I was commanded. And as I prophesied, there was a noise, and suddenly a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. Indeed, as I looked, the sinews and the flesh came upon them, and the skin covered them over. But there was no breath in them. Also, he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy something. Say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe on these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath came into them. And they lived, and stood upon their feet, an exceedingly great army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones of the whole house of Israel, they indeed say, our bones are dry, our hope is lost, and we ourselves are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, behold, O my people, I will open your graves and cause you to come up from your graves and bring you into the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am the Lord. When I have opened your graves, O my people, and brought you up from your graves, I will put my spirit in you and you shall live. And I will place in you your own will. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, spoken it and performed it, says the Lord.
Dry bones and 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 dry phone connected to the phone. The phone connected to the echo phone. The echo phone connected to the leg bone. The leg bone connected to the knee bone. The knee bone connected to the thigh bone. The thigh bone connected to the hip bone. The hip bone connected to the back bone. The back bone connected to the shoulder bone. The shoulder bone connected to the neck bone. The neck bone connected to the head bone. Now hear the word of the Lord. Them bones gotta walk around. Them bones gotta walk around. Them bones gotta walk around. Now hear the word of the Lord. Disconnect them bones and dry bones. Disconnect them bones and dry bones. Disconnect them bones and dry bones. Now hear the word of the Lord. Well, the head bone connected to the neck bone. The neck bone connected to the shoulder bone. The shoulder bone connected to the back bone. The back bone connected to the hip bone. The hip bone connected to the thigh bone. The thigh bone connected to the knee bone. The knee bone connected to the leg bone. The leg bone connected to the ankle bone. The ankle bone connected to the foot bone. The foot bone connected to the toe bone. Now hear the word of the Lord. Them bones and dry bones and bones and bones and dry bones and bones and bones and dry bones. Now hear the word of the Lord. Now hear the word of the Lord. Now hear the word. Oh, hear the word. Oh, hear the word of the Lord.
Them bones and dry bones. Now hear the word of the Lord. I just need 20 minutes. Pray. Ezekiel saw them bones as he peered out into this vision. God posed this dreadful picture depicting post-exilic Israel to reveal how God identified and empathized with his people's feelings. But I'm so glad God didn't stop there. We hear God asking Ezekiel, "Son of man, can these bones live? Bones scattered and tattered. Bones that are very, very many and very, very dry." This question, "Can these bones live?" echoes our search for hope when you consider the valley of dry, dead stuff in your life. You must face this divine inquiry. Can these bones live? When you lay your head on your pillow and anguish over the stuff that keeps you up at night, your dry bones become very clear. And I'm a living testimony that sometimes people of faith face failure, adversity, poverty, and brokenness. Stuff that just doesn't work. About 3 weeks ago, I went to a chiropractor. He said, "Peter, you are 2 to 4 inches shorter than your ideal height. You only stand 6'4", but you should be 6'6" to 6'8" for your frame and size. But you had severe whiplash during your childhood, and so you have a reversed cervical curvature in your neck and vertebrae subluxation in your lower back and major disc degeneration all up and down your spine, and your body flexes in constant fight or flight mode just trying to compensate for your spinal misalignment." And I had just one question for him. Can these bones of mine live? Do I have any hope? He said, "Yes, good news, my friend. We can fix it all." He said, "When I'm finished with you, you'll be at least an inch taller." And I said, "Thank you, Jesus. There is hope for my messed up bones." All my life, I've felt God's healing power for my dry bone situation. At life's school of hard knocks, I've felt God's grace for all my issues. You know, years ago, I lived in such a messed up situation and condition that one elderly gentleman said to me, "Young man, go to college, seek for knowledge, stay there till you're through. If If they can make penicillin out of moldy cheese, they'll sure make something out of you. And so I started out. I started out as an education major, then I switched to a religion major, then I did all the coursework for a master's in software engineering, and then I spent 6.5 years as a real estate investor up in Canada. But God waited till all my prideful ambitions dried up and died. Then God put his word in my heart and breathed new life into me. I know many of you can tell this story of how God brought you through your own valley of death and dry bones to restore your life. But I stand to speak for somebody today who has not yet experienced and encountered this kind of victory. Somebody may be feeling your private pain in a valley of dry bones right now. And so I just came by to speak a word for you today. Like Ezekiel, you peek through your window of your life at your own personal pain, your own personal valley of very, very dry, dead bones. And God's inquiry echoes up and down the corridors of your soul. Can these bones live? For somebody here always struggling to make ends meet, forever dealing with one month at the end of the money. Here's God's question, can these financial bones live? Or somebody struggling in your physical health, you tried everything, but you still suffer chronic pain, and now you feel like all you've got is a pile of medical bills on one side, and the dry, dead bones of bad health on the other side. Just hear God's question to you, can these bones live? Somebody here looking out at the dry bones of a broken relationship. Your marriage died on the rocks and love's sweetness dried up. Somebody told you, who told me just this past week actually, that my marriage feels like a free-range circus. First I had the engagement ring, then I had the wedding ring, and now I've got the suffering. I've got nothing left but a dry, dead relationship with no hope. Hear God's question, can these bones live? Or some single person living with the pain of many attempts at love. Maybe you watched Prince Harry and Meghan Markle wed last night, and that spark of Markle has you wondering, when will my love come at last? Like Dorothy in The Wizard of Oz, you've been going on life's yellow brick road. You dated the Scarecrow, but you found out he had no brain. And then you dated the Tin Man, but you learned he just didn't have the heart for relationship. Then you tried on the Lion, but bless your soul, he didn't have the courage for the relationship. Just hear God's question to you, can these bones live? Or for this community of faith, feeling like we just died and dried up. Well, I hear you say we used to have a full, joyful, exuberant church. I've heard so many of you speak of the good old days of yesterday, the times when you couldn't get parking unless you came early to church, and every pew filled up before the divine hour worship service started. I've heard you talk about the glory of your historical legacy. I've heard many reminisce about the wonderful days of yesterday when the church seemed to thrive and bustle with spiritual joy. Now that attendance declined and membership dropped, and maybe the giving seems down a bit, you wonder, can these bones live? Maybe you feel like this has become a Vallejo of dry bones. I just stopped by to tell you, fear not, my brothers and my sisters. There is hope for you this day. God asks Ezekiel and all of us this question, can these bones live? Clearly the bones can die and rot and stink, but can they live? Can they experience revival, renewal, resurrection, and new life? And I wonder, why must God take Ezekiel to death's valley for this quickly? God raises this question of hope in the very pit of hopelessness. Ezekiel was in the very pit of hopelessness. He watched his entire comrades and friends sit destitute, destroyed, and decimated in a dark, dismal exile.
And so this dreary movie tells us certain joys can be only felt through tears, and some heavenly stars only shine visibly at night. And the restoring hope God offers shows almost in desperate despair, because resurrection can only come sometimes through emptiness and death. And so I read this story in that context, because I discovered in my own life that when my bones seemed driest, that my hopes felt strongest, my songs clearest, my faith dearest, and my God nearest. So the vision of the valley of dry bones carries a message of hope that God injects into Ezekiel's nightmare concerning his defeated nation. And the point of the message says simply, if God can make dry bones live, then God will make a way for you this day. And that's all I came to say to you today. God will carry you through whatever you may face. But often before God delivers breakthrough for you, God will put some question on your mind to force you to search your soul. God asks no questions seeking answers and information, for God understands all dimensions and God knows all things. God always questions to see where you stand in your hope and faith. God asks Adam, where are you? God asks Job, where were you? God asks Cain, where's your brother? God asks to Abraham, is there anything too hard for the Lord? God asks Jacob, what is your name? God asks Moses, what's in your hand? God asks Elijah, what are you doing here? God asks Amos, what do you see? God asks Malachi, with a man around God? And God asks Ezekiel here in this passage, and he asks all of us, can these bones live? But I'm glad God doesn't stop there. He waits for Ezekiel's answer. Easy optimism says yes. Shallow presumption says of course. Simplistic uncertainty says maybe. Giddy enthusiasm says I hope so. Negative pessimism says no way, Jose, possibly. Despairing doubt and despair, depression says I don't think so. Apathetic despair says it's too helpless. Jaded cynicism says what difference would it make anyhow? And resignation says who cares? But a faith that rests securely in the way and will of a sovereign God says, oh Lord, God, thou knowest. I'm so glad God waits for this kind of faith to develop and mature in his children. For this faith sets us up with openness to God's will and God's way. But God didn't stop there at Ezekiel's answer even. Instead, God goes on to give him a peculiar set of instructions. In this powerful vision, God instructs him, speak to the bones. Once again, I'm so glad that God didn't stop there. Well, if God had only stopped there, Ezekiel's talk to the bones might not be so clear. Who knows what Ezekiel might have said? He might have spoken his own words and not God's words. We might not have this dramatic story locked away in Ezekiel 37. But God tells him exactly how to address the bones when he speaks to the bones. The text bears witness that God says in verse 4, say unto the bones, O you dry bones. See, God says, Ezekiel, preface your speech by telling the bones the truth. Don't you pretty it up and don't you soften and speak for reality. Don't you dress it up or fix it up. Don't you sanitize it, politicize it, or euphemize it. Don't you add no spoonful of sugar to make the medicine go down. No, God says, just tell it like it is. Call it like it is. The bones are dead and very, very dry. So say of the bones, oh, you dry bones. You see, that may sound politically incorrect, but that's God's speech. Before God can help and heal and make folks realize, God says you've got to face the facts and tell the truth about your situation. And so Ezekiel speaks to the bones and says, oh, you dry bones. Dry because the sky vultures sucked out all the matters from your inside. Dry because the relentless desert sun unleash you over the many games. Dry because you lost all connection with organic fluids of your body. Dry because you've been dead for a very long time. Dry because you've never been funeralized and buried. Ezekiel examined the bones bone by bone. He acknowledged and faced the facts. And that's what we've got to do right now. We've got to face the facts of our dry bone situations. We've got to confront the horrible realities of this troubled world. Yes, Meghan Markle might have married Prince Harry, but we still have a world of fear and poverty and war and mass shootings. So don't deal in shallow presumptions, easy optimisms and evasions. Don't try to confront people at funerals and tell them not to cry. You've got to cry sometimes when it's time to cry and pray when it's time to pray. We're not told in the Bible not to cry. We're told not to cry as those who have no hope. But you still got to cry sometimes. You still got to wring your hands and pinch the floor sometimes. You still got to say, Father, I stretch my hands to thee. No other help I know. Shouldst thou withdraw thyself from me, whither shall I go? In our culture, most of us don't like to take sin very seriously. We don't see how sin deadens our nerves and dries up our bones. And so we hide our sins beneath deceptive euphemisms. We don't call a thief a thief, but we call him a kleptomaniac. We don't call a lie a bold-faced lie, but we call it a petty prevarication. We don't call failure failure, but we call it the mere achievement of an incomplete success. We don't call adultery adultery, but we call it keeping your options open. We don't call killing killing, but we call it national security. We don't call discrimination discrimination, we call it the elimination of the unqualified. We don't call shacking up, but we call it a period of tasting and testing and teasing and pleasing and feeling, testing the waters, trying on something, something. We don't call death death. We call it a mere transition or a metamorphosis. But I declare today it takes faith to face the facts and trust God in the valley of your dry bones. And if you tell the truth about your situation and face the facts about your issues, then God can set you up for breakthrough and victory. Faith has taught me that where there's a problem, there's a possibility. Faith has taught me that where there's an obstacle, there's an opportunity. Wherever there's a valley, there is a victory. Wherever there's a will, there's a way. Wherever there's sin, there's a savior. Wherever there's death, there's deliverance. Faith has taught me that God can do anything but fail. Faith has taught me that there's no problem that God cannot solve. There's no mess God can't fix. There's no prayer God can't answer. There's no sin God can't forgive. No barrier God can't break. No death God can't resuscitate. And no destruction God cannot reverse. By faith, prophet Ezekiel faced the facts and called it like it is. Address the bones and say to the bones, Ezekiel, oh, you dry bones. But I'm so glad God didn't stop there. God says, go beyond the talk of their condition and tell them of their recondition. God says, prophesy upon the bones. That means preach to the bones and say, hear the word of the Lord. I know you ain't got nothing but death, but preach to death. I know you ain't got nothing but bones, but just preach to the bones. You have no theological evidence. You may have no archaeological witness, but preach anyhow. Preach to the bones and say, oh, you dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. And I challenge you this day to speak God's word over all your situations and preach to the bones, the circumstances and the issues you face in your life, and you'll find God has power to transform your situation. But I promise you, God and God's power doesn't stop there. God's power moves through the preached word and beyond the preached word. The text says they heard a mighty noise and the bones started coming together. The phalanges bones connected to the metatarsals, and the metatarsals connected to the tarsals, and the tarsals connected to the talus, and the talus connected to the tibia, and the tibia connected to the fibula, and the fibula connected to the patella, and the patella connected to the femur. femur, and the femur connected to the coxal, and the coxal connected to the sacrum, and the sacrum connected to the vertebrae. But Ezekiel couldn't say all of that, so he just said the foot bone connected to the ankle bone, and the ankle bone connected to the shin bone, and the shin bone connected to the knee bone, and the knee bone connected to the leg bone, and the leg bone connected to the hip bone, and the hip bone connected to the back bone, and the back bone connected to the chest bone, and the chest bone connected to the arm bone, and the arm bone connected to the shoulder bone, and the shoulder bone connected to the neck bone, and the neck bone connected to the head bone. Bones come together with bones when the word of the God is preached. Oh, people of Vallejo Drive, God's word puts stuff back together. The Bible, God's written word, tells how Jesus, God's living word, carries a mighty power to put your bones, your dry bone situations back together. I just stopped by to tell somebody that when you declare God's word, your situation changes. Your dry bones start moving and reorganizing. But I want you to know, God doesn't stop there. Because the preached word brought the bones together, but they still stood up stuck and dead and lifeless and immobilized. Oh, I got to quit now, but God says, Prophet Ezekiel, speak to the wind and say, O breath, come upon these slain that they might live. So Ezekiel prophesied to the wind, and the Spirit came, and the Spirit gives life. I hear him saying in the words of this song, breathe on us, breath of God. Fill us with life anew, that we may love what thou dost love and do what thou wouldst do. And my brothers and my sisters, if we can bring this prayer and sing this song, we will get new life in all areas of our life. Jesus died to make this new life possible, and he promises the gift of the Holy Spirit to all who died with him, are buried with him, but are risen with him to live with him. And my dear Christian friends, I'm so glad that it doesn't stop there. This new life that God gives through God's Spirit lives on and on and on and on eternally and forever. Oh, if you want it, if you want that new life this day, I invite you to stand with me all over the building as we sing this song of consecration and commitment. Breathe on me, breath of God. Won't you stand and sing this song together? Fill me with life for you. Rising up and in your sitting down, in your laughter and in your sorrow, in your labor and in your leisure, until you come to the place where there is no more sunset and no dawning. Amen. God bless you. We've got an announcement that there's some cake in honor of the Mother of the Year for everybody in the town. God bless you.